Konicek Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio LLC presents Galactic Football League 6, The Gangster, Part 2, by Scott Sigler. Narrated by Michael John Casey and performed by a full cast. Galactic Football League 6, The Gangster, Part 2. For Quentin, days passed in the smaller ship. Days without official charge, arraignment, or any notice of where he was. Early morning, afternoon, and evening, as best as he could tell with no palm up or any way to gauge the passage of time, a trail of food slid in through a slot in the crystal wall. He ate everything given to him. When done, he had to slide the tray back through the wall slot, or they wouldn't give him more at the next mealtime. The ship punched in and out with no warning. When it did, reality dissolved into a shimmer, and whatever meal Quentin had in his gut came up. Sometimes he made it to the toilet, sometimes not. He'd never thought there would come a day when he'd miss the golden puke bucket. When he threw up on the floor, tiger stripe or angel wings slid towels through the slot. Quentin cleaned up as best he could and slid the soiled towels back out again. His cell reeked of vomit. No one came to ask him questions. No one came at all. After almost a week and shortly after the fourth punch in one day, tiger stripe and angel wings stood in front of his cell, six black armored Kredorakians fluttering in the air around them. The Kredorakian soldiers held entropic rifles. The section of cell wall hissed up. The restraints and helmet were inside the space.
Put them on. We've arrived.
Quentin's gaze flicked to the Kredorakians.
Arrived where? I've got rights, you know.
Angel Wings shook her head.
You lost those when you broke the law.
What law? I didn't do anything. Come on, it's been days since I bathed. I smell like puke. Where are you taking me?
Tiger Stripe nodded toward the restraints.
Put those on, or the guards will stun you and we'll put them on you. You're wearing them either way.
Shuck. Should have fought back on the Hypatia.
Quentin put the restraints on, and once the sensors detected his hands, they cinched down on his wrists.
I'm coming in. Be smart, and don't try anything.
The crystal cell door opened. Angel Wings came in, took the helmet, and slid it on Quentin's head. She pressed the button on the helmet, and the world went black. The first lash of electricity seemed to throw him backward in time. He was 19 again, at the GFL Combine, wrists and ankles clamped by shackles, a flock of Kredorakians shouting questions as they blasted him again and again with high voltage. They wanted to know if he had mods, if he had connections to terrorist organizations, a confusing, agonizing test that determined whether he could join the upper tiers or whether he would forever wallow in Tier 3. The second lash ripped him back to the present. Quentin was once again shackled to a metal rack in the shape of a large X, electricity coursing through him. Every muscle fiber in his body contracted, every nerve screamed. The blast held him in its tight grip, paralyzed him completely. The flow stopped, and his body sagged.
How many members are there in the Church of Quentin Barnes?
Quentin's head hung low, just two jolts, and he was already exhausted. He slowly looked up, stared out from under his eyebrows at the silver-suited Kredorakian perched on a post a few feet away. His six eyes stared back at him.
I don't know! I told you! I got nothing to do with the church!
Lies bring pain.
A third blast made flesh and bone vibrate with agony. The third lasted longer than the second, which had lasted longer than the first. Quentin's jaw clenched tight, his face screwed into a rictus of pain. The electricity stopped. His body slumped forward. He hung there, exhausted, arms angled behind him as if he were flash frozen in a clumsy dive into a pool.
How many members in the Church of Quentin Barnes?
I told you, I don't know!
Boss 15's leathery wings ruffled once, then settled back down again against the silver bodysuit.
We have information contrary to your claims. We have learned that the three main branches are not actually separate and independent organizations. There was no schism.
Quentin felt a wave of fear as powerful as the electric shocks themselves.
But they did split. Yolanda Davenport broke the story.
A story that you undoubtedly helped perpetrate in order to circumvent Kretorakian law. You control all sects.
Quentin felt pure panic coming on, fought to control it, to keep it at bay. The CMR knew about that meeting. Although he had no connection to any of the sects, Quentin had created the schism story, which they thought meant he was in charge of the churches. Only a handful of sentients knew the truth. Quentin, Richfield, Hoyt Bogard, Who Love Q, and Rob Froese. And Missal the Efficient. Missal had set up the meeting on Ionith, an event so secret that not even Becca, Fred, or Chodo knew about it. Missal had quietly arranged for Richfield and the others to attend. Quentin had made sure there was no record of the meeting, no witnesses, no electronic trail even hinting at it. The face-to-face discussion had taken not even an hour, and all had left promising to keep it secret forever. When Quentin had asked Missal's help in making a move against Gredok, the worker had been furious and hurt. Quentin's mind raced if Missal had ratted him out to the CMR to stop him from trying to use the Gibbeljuance against Gredok. Or if Missal had told Gredok about the meeting.
It's a lie. Whoever told you is lying. Whatever they told you is a lie. I have zero involvement with those churches.
Do you deny you had a covert meeting with the sentients who became the leaders of the Church of Quentin Barnes, the Orthodox Barnesian Separatists, and the Reformed House of Quentinism, the three largest denominations of those who worship you?
The pain crept higher. He wavered on lying but had no idea what the Kretorakians really knew. The blast of electricity froze him, then stopped.
Quit it, you shucking bats! Just quit it!
You are lying. You secretly met with the heads of the three largest denominations dedicated to you. We know this because we have sworn testimony about it from Gredok the Splithead.
Quentin went cold. Missal must have told Gredok about the meeting. The worker had sold him out, and in doing so, given Gredok the ability to have Quentin put away.
Did you, or did you not, meet with the heads of the three churches?
It didn't make any sense. Gredok was working with Frederico to find out who was behind the New York City attack. Or was that just another ploy by Gredok to get Quentin to lower his guard?
Did you, or did you not, meet with the heads of the three churches?
Yes, I mean no. I don't deny it, but they told me the church was splitting up. I wanted nothing to do with the Church of Quentin Barnes, and I still don't.
How many members in the Church of Quentin Barnes?
Quentin hung there, frozen in futility, wrists and ankles bound tight, knowing nothing he could say would stop any of this, knowing that Gredok had won.
I don't know how many members there are.
Agony again coursed up and down his body, made him jerk and thrash. When it finally stopped, the pain didn't just go away. It ebbed, like a tuning fork's vibration slowly fading to nothing. A sharp stinging in his mouth. His tongue probed the spot and found a small space where there should have been none. Quentin lifted his head and spit his broken tooth out at the Kretorakian. The chip of jagged white enamel hit along with a glob of blood the surprising interrogator, making it flap off its post.
You have assaulted an Imperial official.
Always that tooth. You cheap bastards could have at least given me a mouth guard.
The Kretorakian flapped back to his post, settled to it, but kept its leathery wings half unfurled.
Your answers are unsatisfactory. We will continue to increase the durations until you talk.
Quentin spit out another glob of blood. He tried to hit the Kretorakian, but it missed. The glob arced down to the floor, wet red against black metal.
Well, I guess we're in for a long night, because I don't know crap.
Boss 15 flapped his wings twice, then furled them tightly.
Our instruments tell us when you're lying. Tell the truth. What knowledge do Commissioner Froese and Yolanda Davenport have of your duplicity?
Quentin tried to think. Yolanda Davenport had no idea the schism was false. She'd simply reported the story that Quentin had given her. Froese, though, did know. He'd had little to do with it, but he'd provided the backstory needed to make it look like the schism had happened on its own. and Gredok hated Frost almost as much as he hated Quentin. Frost had done little more than create some false flight records and given Yolanda a couple of quotes, but even those small things now meant the commissioner's career was at risk, maybe even his life. No matter what happened, Quentin could not reveal the man's involvement. He had to protect Frost.
They don't know anything. How could they when this is all a bunch of lies?
How many members in the Church of Quentin Barnes? You will answer now, or you will receive the longest shock yet.
Quentin closed his eyes. He took a minute to clench his teeth, careful that his tongue was pressed against the roof of his mouth, to concentrate on not breaking any more teeth or biting off his own tongue. He shook his head.
Welcome to GNN's Main Feed with Brad Chavez, Joanna Stella on traffic and intergalactic novi, and Remy Kasich on sports. And here's Brad Chavez.
Good evening, beings across the galaxies. This is GNN's Main Feed, and I'm Brad Chavez. Our top story tonight has to do with the recent Galaxy Bowl champions. Ionith Kraken's quarterback, Quentin Barnes, was in Earth orbit when his yacht was boarded by Kredorakian military from the warship Hammerwind. Shortly after, Barnes, and Barnes alone, was removed from the yacht. The incident happened 5 days ago, Galactic Central Time, 6 days ago, Ionith Time. Barnes, a two-time GFL champion quarterback, was the 2686 League MVP. Also aboard the yacht was Rebecca Montaigne, an all-pro fullback from the Krakens, is also a two-time GFL champion and the MVP of Galaxy Bowl 28. She's also the wife and teammate of Barnes. The two had only recently wed in a private ceremony on Earth. There is some speculation that the couple was about to depart for the human post-nuptial voyage known as a honeymoon. Montaigne has released a statement and had this to say.
Quentin was abducted at gunpoint. They claimed he was in violation of the Religious Organization Act. He had no legal representation. We have not heard from him since and have no word from the Kredorakian Empire or the Quith Concordia government as to his location or his health.
Initial information requests sent to the Kredorakian Empire went unanswered, as did requests sent to the Kredorakian Ministry of Religion, CMR, the imperial division that manages religious concerns. Hours after Montaigne's statement, Charlton the Moral, Lord Governor of the Quith Concordia, released a statement regarding the situation and issued a rare rebuke of imperial policy. Quote, Quentin Barnes is a Concordian and is due all rights granted to citizens of the Concordia. I demand full accountability from the Empire regarding this arrest, end quote. 5 months ago, Kraken's backup quarterback, Yitzhak Goldman, was arrested for illegal mods. Imperial spokesbeings say Goldman is being held at a detainment facility in Kredorakian territory, but have not offered the name of that facility. Goldman, also a full citizen of the Concordia, is an extremely popular figure on Ionith, and his arrest and detainment spurred large protests in Ionith City. Ionith City authorities, who wished to remain anonymous, stated they feared this second arrest of a gridiron player could exacerbate those protests. Masal the Efficient, the official media representative for the Ionith Kraken's front office, had this to say.
We have no knowledge of the circumstances of Mr. Barnes' detention. While we do not doubt Miss Montaigne's claims, we have received no contact from the Kredorakian Ministry of Religion or the Empire Bureau of Species Interaction. Our own efforts to contact Mr. Barnes have gone unanswered.
Barnes was the presumed target of a recent violent incident at Randall Hospital, New York City, Earth. Three armed assailants attacked the facility, presumably in an assassination attempt on Barnes. All three assailants died during the attack. Barnes was also injured during a terrorist attack on the Touchback, the Kraken's team vessel, at Jupiter shortly before Galaxy Bowl 28. It is unknown if the alleged detainment of Barnes is related to either of those incidents. More on this as it develops. Coming up, could something in your home be the ultimate danger to your children? We'll have experts to discuss it when we come back.
Quentin woke. Every muscle hurt. He opened his eyes, saw no light, none at all. He was on his side, lying on a rough, cold, unforgiving stone floor. His body shook, half from the cold, half from the reverberations of pain still coursing through his memory. His muscles ached from the repeated contractions, from the on-and-off blasts of voltage. Restraints bound his hands, locked together at the wrists, as if he was forever caught in an almost praying position. He didn't remember being brought here, wherever here was. He must have passed out during the torture. Quentin shivered and realized he was naked, nothing between his skin and the cold stone floor. The small cell on the ship Tiger Stripe and Angel Wings had flown here now seemed like an impossible luxury. The constant cold was as much a part of their plan to break him down as the shocks were. They would put him on the X again. They kept coming here, dragging him out, putting him on that horrid machine, asking him questions. Quentin wondered just how much more he could take. Whatever answers his captors wanted, he simply didn't have them. He had to stay strong. He had to survive. He had to get back to Becca. He had to get himself under control. He was shackled and imprisoned in the dark, but he was still the master of his discipline. Start with what you can control, then build toward what you can't. He closed his eyes. Not that it made any difference in this pitch-black cell. He started with his breath. In through his nose, out through his mouth. Quentin felt his tension dial back a notch, and with it, some of the pain. An ear-splitting metal screech, the cell door opened outward, flooding the room with blinding light. A shadow silhouetted in that light, a man moving toward him. Quentin kicked out with a foot, felt it glance against something hard, body armor.
He's a live one. Zap him.
A second man stepped up before Quentin could utter a protest. Two shock prods jabbed into his ribs, his chest. His body twitched and jerked, his mouth filled with the taste of blood. Something slammed into his head, so hard even the darkness spun.
That'll teach you, big boy. Help me with him.
Big hands, cold with leather and armor, slid under Quentin's armpits, raised him halfway up, and dragged him out of the cell.
Memorandum to the Imperial Council of the Kretorakian Empire, hand carried by a representative of the Kretorakian Ministry of Religion, CMR. The capture and isolation of Quentin Barnes has caused unforeseen negative effects. Mistakes were made in his initial apprehension. Witnesses were not detained and isolated. Those witnesses have contacted multiple media outlets with the information that Imperial forces arrested Barnes. The general public is now operating on the knowledge that Barnes is being held captive by the Empire in an unknown location. Some speculated that he may already be dead. In particular, Rebecca Montaigne, Heavy G, spouse of Barnes, has repeatedly utilized the media to share her story of Barnes' arrest. An imperial edict has been issued that Montaigne is fomenting dissent and that media outlets should be aware that she is spreading false news. All imperial ships and garrisons have been notified that Montaigne is to be taken into custody on site, under the guise that the detainment will be for her personal safety. The standing order is to detain her as quietly as possible. At the time of this memorandum, she is still at large. Montaigne is presumed to be aboard the Hypatia, the private starship of Quentin Barnes. The whereabouts of that ship are unknown. Montaigne is now number one on the Empire's most wanted list. While the CMR has isolated many threats in the past, it has never done so with a sentient as famous as Quentin Barnes. Based on an evaluation of media mentions, randomly sampled intergalactic communications to determine occurrences of Barnes' name, the number of followers he has in various churches dedicated to him, and the amount of merchandise sold that bears his name and/or jersey number, Barnes is, quite possibly, the most well-known sentient that has ever existed. It is possible that the CMR did not properly account for his public prominence and the potential subsequent impacts removing him might incur. The reaction from the galactic populace has, thus far, resulted in the loss of over 500 sentient lives and caused over 20 million credits in damages to Imperial facilities.
In previous similar situations, the property damage and loss of life was far lower. In those instances, we were able to either wait out the reactions, which tended to fade quickly, or completely eliminate the primary groups of protesters. With the situation of Quentin Barnes, neither of those options seems likely. In the 13 days, standard time, since isolating Barnes, galaxy-wide protests have increased from one or two a day to as many as 10 per day. Protests are increasing in both frequency and in the average number of sentients involved in each event. Instead of fading away, the protests seem to be gaining momentum. As for detaining and/or eliminating the protesters, at this point it would either overwhelm local holding facilities or result in a loss of life estimated in excess of 4 million sentients. The CMR feels that either of these options would generate an exponential increase in further demonstrations. There are also unforeseen political complications with the Quith Concordia. The Lord Governor of the Concordia is demanding information on Barnes, who is a Concordia citizen. The Lord Governor is likely using this situation to better align himself with Barnes, due to Barnes' massive popularity in that system. The Imperial Council asked this CMR to estimate the short and long-term ramifications of eliminating Quentin Barnes. At this time, we feel any public execution would drastically increase the current levels of protest. We also believe that the protest movement is of such size that it will not go away if Barnes is quietly executed and never heard from again. Therefore, we do not recommend either option. As for further recommendations, we feel these are the only logical options currently available. Fast-track a public trial for Barnes with a predetermined result of execution for crimes against the Empire. Execute Barnes and blame the death on an attempted escape. Move Barnes to a public detention facility and make his good health publicly known until the Empire can determine how best to handle the situation. Continue to keep him isolated in the current facility until the Empire can determine how best to handle the situation. Release Barnes immediately. We feel that the first two choices have the potential to cause costly, long-term damage to the Empire. At this point, due to the growing intensity of galaxy-wide demonstrations, we cannot accurately estimate the public's reaction to Barnes dying in captivity. His death, by any means, is likely to immediately elevate him to martyr status. Moving him to a public facility may mitigate the current level of protest, or it may increase said level. We have no precedent upon which to predict the outcome of this strategy. Releasing Barnes outright would assuredly end all protests. However, this would result in the likely perception that the Empire has capitulated to public pressure, thereby creating a precedent that protests of sufficient size can effectively alter the Empire's decisions. Therefore, at this time, we recommend keeping Barnes isolated and offer no response to public inquiries as to his status. In time, the level of protest may die down due to the naturally short attention spans of non-Kretorakian species. If the level of protest continues or even increases, the Imperial Council may then implement one of the other choices. End of memorandum.
Quentin no longer feared the darkness. When it was dark, no one hurt him. He lay curled in a fetal position, body shivering uncontrollably. Struggling to convince himself that controlling his breath brought him any level of security or sanity. The Kretorakians controlled everything. If he ate or went hungry, if he slept or was kept awake. They controlled food, they controlled light, they controlled pain. With no sunlight or stars or moon to track the time, no clocks or even sleep, the time slipped. It could have been days, weeks, or even months. It seemed that every time he closed his eyes and pushed away the cold, the pain, and the fear long enough to actually fall asleep, he was woken immediately by pulsing lights and sirens screaming from hidden speaker film. But those jarring moments were still preferable to the thing that woke him up more often than not: the metal squeal of a cell door opening, the announcement of another torture session. He lost track of how many times that he'd been hauled from his cell, sometimes with a beating by shock prods, sometimes with billy clubs, sometimes by simple fists, dragging him down a cold hallway and chained to the metal X that sent agony through his body over and over and over again. He'd begged for it to stop, but they just kept asking questions he couldn't answer. They wanted to know about the Church of Quentin Barnes. It was the fourth session when he'd cracked. Constant waves of agony rippling through his body and right into his soul, screaming at him to find a way to end the hurt. He'd fully confessed to the secret meeting on Ionath with Ridgefield, Who Love Q, and Hoyt Bogard. He'd confessed to the meeting on the Touchback several weeks before that, when they first learned that the church had 250 million followers, and he'd confessed to knowing that number, to understanding that number made him a threat to the Empire, confessed that number was why he'd come up with the schism plan in the first place. He'd told them Frost had helped with the schism story. He'd told them everything, yet the sessions continued. They asked a few simple questions about Froze, but overall they didn't seem to care about his minor involvement. Quentin told them that Masal had set up both meetings, but never asked a single follow-up question. The torture continued as his sanity started to slip, and he began to wonder if everything before the X was a dream. He wondered if pain was the only reality he'd ever known. Telling the truth didn't stop the torture, so he made things up. A small part of him wondered if these words were a death sentence to the sect leaders, to anyone else. He didn't care. He was in pain, and pain was him. He told them anything he thought they wanted to hear. Quentin said so many things he no longer remembered what was actually true, because truth had ceased to be about anything but a word. He sold out his friends, he sold out his family, he sold out his teammates. He knew it was wrong, he knew he was weak, but none of it mattered. The only person he would not implicate was Becca. They asked if Rebecca Montaigne was involved. They wanted to know where she was. He didn't know. They wanted to know how to find the Hypatia. He didn't know that either, and fortunately that was the truth. The only silver lining to that line of questioning was that they didn't ask any questions about the yacht's tech or the upgrades the Porteth had made. The Kredorakian still didn't know Quentin had visited the Porteth Cloud or that Fred and Janine had flown the Hypatia there. No matter how bad the pain became, no matter what lies or truths he told, he could not implicate Becca in any way. When the agony was so intense and burned for so long that he vomited what little food he had in him, even then he would not say she was involved, because he wasn't protecting just Becca. He was protecting her and the baby. His pregnant wife was the one thin thread that kept him tethered to reality. In a world of darkness and cold and noise, in a world of endless suffering, she was the only thing that kept him from smashing his own head against the stone floor until his skull caved in. But how much longer until he reached his absolute limit? And when he reached it, what then? He would go mad, and madness would be a relief, a blessing. Maybe the pain wouldn't stop, but it wouldn't be happening to him anymore. The suffering would belong to someone else, someone new. That was how he would beat them, simply to go insane. They wouldn't know. He'd hide inside his own head, and when it was all over and the pain stopped and the light returned and he could sleep without shivering like a frightened insect, then he could come back and be himself again and see Becca and the baby and his friends and sleep in a warm bed. Quentin heard someone laughing. It took him a moment to realize the laughter was his own. That frightened him even worse than being chained to the metal X.
I want, please, deliver me.
Then he heard the heavy bolts in his cell door sliding open, the noise that brought anxious terror, the sound that was a harbinger of pain. Quentin shut his eyes against the light. He waited for the hell to begin.
Get me a blanket, now.
He doesn't need a shucking blanket.
I'm the doctor here.
And I'm in charge of this wing. That son of a bitch cost me a fortune when I bet on the Jacks in the Galaxy Bowl. He can freeze his ass off for all I care.
Quentin tried to open his eyes, tried to see through the light that sliced into his brain. Two moving shapes, maybe more. Something touched his shoulder. He jerked away and scooted across the rough floor until his back was against the stone wall.
Get him a blanket.
Lady, I already told you no. You're getting on my nerves, you know that? He's gonna rot in here. So why bother comforting him?
His fingers and nose are blue. That's hypothermia. Mild, but prolonged enough to cause permanent damage. Maybe the Kredorakians will let him go. He's famous, remember? Physical damage could lead to a prolonged investigation, which could mean people asking questions about this facility. And if that happens, it all comes back to you.
Me? How could it come back to me?
Because I will list on today's report that you refuse to help a guest receive basic treatment. Plus, you are in charge of this wing. If this goes bad, you think higher ups won't dump it on a mid-level guard? Trust me, if this comes out, it will fall on you.
Quentin's eyes were adjusting to the light, just enough to make out a woman on one knee. Behind her, a man in gray armor, standing in the doorway.
I'll go get a blanket.
The woman nodded.
Make it fast.
The man's shape left.
I'm going to touch your hand now, all right? All right, Mr. Barnes?
Quentin shook his head, but she gently took his hand anyway. Her skin felt hot on his. He felt her fingers press into his wrist just below his thumb, just above the restraints. White skin. She was of Tower descent. Short gray hair, wrinkled eyes, gray uniform, same as the human techs he'd glimpsed when he was dragged into the torture room. She leaned closer, as if examining his hands.
Listen to me carefully. You are in bad shape. I'm going to examine you, but you need to listen. You have to hold on. Stay alive. Help is coming. You won't see me again. Say nothing about what I'm telling you. Help is coming. If you understand me, nod.
Quentin nodded, then flinched as the armored guard strolled back into the room.
Here's your damn blanket.
The man threw it to the cell floor, then the woman gently wrapped the blanket around Quentin's shoulders.
Now get going with your exam. I don't know why you're even bothering. The bats aren't going to release him. He's going to die here, and we all know it.
I'm not here for your insight. Now, Mr. Barnes, it's important you cooperate with my exam and do exactly what I ask you to do. If you don't, I'm afraid Carmago will use his shock prod. Nod if you understand.
Quentin couldn't see the guard's face as it was hidden behind the gray helmet's black visor. But he could see the guard's hand. The hand reached for a holster on the guard's right thigh and pulled out a shock prod. His hand gripped the handle. The thumb pressed the activation button. The shock prod hummed. Quentin nodded violently.
Good. Now let's begin.
Welcome to GSN's Just a Minute with Dan Gianni, Akbar Smith, and Tarot the Smasher.
Hello again, sports fans. I'm Dan Gianni, back to you once again, as always, with my faithful companion, Akbar Smith, and Hall of Fame linebacker, Tarot the Smasher.
We have a surprise guest today, Dan.
We most certainly do. A most unexpected guest. I mean, we didn't have her on the schedule, so, it's not like we asked her to call in. And I think it's important to make clear that we aren't supporting...
Dan, folks, we have the Galaxy Bowl MVP calling into our studio. No paranoia about governmental opinion is more important than that.
Hey now, Tarot. This has nothing to do with the government. We happen to have a pretty tight schedule for the show, and I'm not sure...
Dan, you are so full of crap. Are you going to welcome our guest or not?
Oh, of course. Sports fans, calling us today by total and complete surprise is Ionath Krakens All-Pro, fullback, and Galaxy Bowl 28 MVP, Becca the Rekka Montaigne.
Thank you for letting me join your show.
We're honored, Rekka. Truly.
And Dan does not mind you calling in unexpectedly. Do you, Dan?
No, of course not.
You're in real time, Rekka. Are you near our studios?
I'd rather not comment about my location right now.
Of course. So, Rekka, what are your thoughts on the chances of the Krakens repeating this year?
With Barnes missing, your question is about the game? Dan, I'm surprised your ribs don't fall out of your body because without a spine, there's nothing to hold them in place.
Wait just a damn minute here, Akbar. You cannot...
Becca, as one respected warrior to another, please say what you came to say. Dan will now be extremely quiet and allow you to speak.
We have censors. We have an imperial edict that says Montaigne is spreading...
Dan, should I come over to your seat and state my case more succinctly?
Go ahead, Rekka.
Thank you. Quentin Barnes, my teammate and husband, was arrested by Kredorakian forces. He's still missing.
I thought this show would be a good place to get the message out.
The message is certainly out in the Concordia and in the Sklorno Dynasty. I've seen the coverage of protests directed against Kredorakian facilities.
It is a sad state of affairs. The protesting has caused injuries and deaths. Has there been no word as to the whereabouts of Quentin?
None whatsoever. The Imperial government will not respond to my requests. They're trying to shut me up, which is why they put out that BS edict. Our teammates are camped out at dozens of Kredorakian offices, peacefully protesting the illegal detention of my husband. The Tweety brothers have already been arrested twice for demanding information. And I believe the Krakens organization is trying to find Quentin as well, although I can't be sure of that.
How long has Quentin been gone?
He was abducted by the Kredorakian military 17 standard days ago.
Abducted? That seems like a strong word, don't you think? I mean, they wouldn't arrest a citizen for nothing. He had to have done something that...
Dan, I am coming to your side of the table.
I have to go to the bathroom. Bathroom break, I'll be right back.
Rekka, you haven't heard from Barnes at all? Not one word over the 2 weeks?
No, not a word. We don't know where he is. We don't know if he's safe. We don't even know if he's still alive.
What about his lawyers? You've heard from them, right?
He had no legal representative with him when he was taken. And as far as I know, he still has none. I haven't heard from anyone.
No representation? This is an outrage. Concordia citizens have the constitutional right to an attorney.
That is the nature of the Kredorakian Empire. Their laws supersede local rights on Quith planets. Only the orbital stations are completely independent of Imperial law.
Rekka, we feel for you. Football fans across the galaxy do as well. This show has a wide reach. What do you hope to accomplish on today's show?
I want the Ministry of Religion to know that the people are watching them. Quentin did nothing wrong. All he wants to do is play football and be the best he can be. They had no right to take him. I want the Empire to know that sentients aren't just going to sit around forever and watch their loved ones be kidnapped, watch people disappear. The Empire needs to know that actions have consequences.
Based on the recent reports of violence committed in the name of Quentin, I believe they are getting that message. How could they not?
I don't want anyone getting killed or even hurt. Quentin wouldn't want that either. So please, everyone listening to my voice, abstain from violence. Don't give the Empire a reason to strike back at you. We need to keep the pressure on them, but if there's too much violence, I fear they'll kill Quentin just to make him go away for good.
Wow, that's a hell of a claim.
I know it is, but that's the reality we're facing right now. He's been gone for 17 standard days. The Empire needs to figure out they've messed with the wrong sentient. Hear me. If any harm comes to Quentin Barnes, if he dies in captivity, the Empire will be sorry. The Empire...
Rekka, who is that? Is someone there with you?
I have to go. Let me just add that the Empire is...
Becca? Becca, are you there? Well, it seems we have lost connection with Galaxy Bowl 28 MVP Rebecca Montaigne. We'll have more to talk about sports around the galaxy. You're watching Just a Minute.
Quentin woke to the vibration felt in the stone floor beneath him, a shuddering tremor, distant, fast, but violent. Karamago the guard had taken away his blanket, and so Quentin lay on his side in the dark cell, naked, shivering, his body unsure if it was on a rack, feeling the jolts, or if it was the ever-present echo. Another vibration, stronger, closer. Quentin wondered if the prison was under attack. The words of the doctor with a crackly voice came back to him. Stay alive, help is coming. He tried to remember how many days it had been since he'd heard that. Was it weeks? Or even months? His mind flashed on his family, the people who claimed to love him. Where was Becca? Where were Ma and Jew and John and the others? His despair made him want to die. His panic made him want to kill. Most of all, he wanted to slip into a madness so that he might not suffer further. That explosion. He wondered if it was an accident, some kind of a breakout attempt, or even a riot. In his fear, he wondered if the prisoners were rising up, trying to escape, Would Carmago and the Kredorakians blame him for it? He heard his cell door unlock, the mechanized grinding sound that had become synonymous with agony. Quentin scuttled back to the stone wall, shaking his head. Distant memories of the prideful man he'd once been. The man who thought he would not break, could not break. The man who wanted back on the field so bad he had a gash on his arm sewed up with a Kevlar stitching gun meant to repair jerseys. The man who had a finger cut off to stay in a game. The man who took all the punishment the galaxy could dish out and kept getting up, kept moving forward, kept attacking. The memories of that man, they weren't memories of him. His breath sucked in and shot out. The pain was coming. His shackled hands shook as he could already feel the shock prods jamming into his ribs, his stomach, his face. He could already feel the guards dragging him down the hall, past the closed cell doors of the other inmates he'd never seen, his frigid skin scraping on the metal, grating on the exposed rock. He could already feel them binding his wrists and ankles to the metal X. Quentin raised his face to the cell door, his eyes wild.
Don't come near me! You come near me, I'll kill you, I swear it!
His words registered in his own mind. He'd threatened his captors. Now they would hurt him even worse.
I won't kill you. I won't fight. I'll be good. Just don't touch me. Don't touch me.
The metallic screech of the door swinging outward, but it only opened a little, angling a silver light across the cell floor. Quentin stared, wide-eyed, nostrils flaring, waiting for the guards to come in. But no one did. Quentin heard no noises, no footsteps. He couldn't move, just sat there and trembled. He waited 1 minute, which felt like 10, then slowly crawled to the door, the motion awkward with his wrists shackled together. He felt the rough stone against his knees and hands, against his toes till he reached the door. He coiled, got his feet beneath him. He squatted low, an animal ready to dart away from danger. But the door didn't open further. It didn't move at all. Body trembling, he slowly stood, reached out and put his hand against the door, and pushed it gently. It opened a few inches more. Nothing. He leaned out and looked down the empty corridor. He saw other cell doors, green paint pitted and spotted with rust, also slightly open. At the end of the corridor, a heavy door with a small riveted window. He'd seen that door in fits and starts when they dragged him through it on the way to the X. At the base of the door lay a human, gray armor, unmoving. Blood on the floor around his body. The floor vibrated again, twice in rapid succession. Distant shouts and screams made him wonder if other prisoners were rioting. His mind swung to believing it was a trick. They kept asking where Becca was, and now maybe they wanted to fool him in leading them to her. But if this was real, if there was any...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.